All right, in this next segment, we will quickly go over the coding template for the 3D problem on homework 3. So we'll go straight to the code. There actually isn't a lot that's different, just a few small changes. We'll start with the source file. You can see, of course, we've changed dimension to equal 3, as you'd expect. Now the vector defining the mesh size, so the number of elements in each direction, of course we added on a third dimension, so in the Z direction, you can specify the number of elements. So here, for this example, it's a 4x8x2 element mesh in 3D. I've also included the .h file, the header file for the 3D problem. All right, so just those three small problems. Let's go over to the template file itself. No changes in the header file. Here in the declaration of our objects and functions, you can see that for the basis function and basis gradient, we now accept as an input C3, since we have the third dimension now. Same for both. Of course, the outputs are still the same, double and vector of doubles. And the rest of these functions, the declarations are exactly the same, and the same with all these data objects. Okay, so just that one small change in the function declarations. We'll scroll down. And the constructor you can see is the same. I don't know if I pointed this out though in the 2D problem. Here this is one because we're using linear basis functions always. This is one because we're using linear basis functions always. And this is one because there's 1 degree of freedom per node. Okay, the destructor is also the same. All right, moving back down to the basis functions and basis gradient. We've already covered the difference here. It's just that you have a third input. However, again, we have to watch out for the DL2 node numbering. All right, so let's go to the board quickly. In the lectures, we again went around in a more sequential manner. For DL2, we follow the same method of going in the same direction. So let me write out give some axes here. So if this is C1, C2 is going back into the screen, and C3 is pointing up. And if you were to look at just the bottom half, so just looking in the C1, C2 plane, you would see that DL2 is consistent going from 2D to 3D. So we go 0, 1, 2, 3. You can see that's the same as the numbering in the 2D problem. Now we shift up to the plane at C3 equals 1, and we just continue going left to right. So we get 4, 5, 6, and 7. Okay, so again, you'll need to use this node numbering as you're defining your basis functions and your basis gradients, all right? And again, you can do those with an if statement, or you could even set it up as a tensor product of the 1D basis functions. That's up to you. All right. Now again, for the basis function gradient, we are storing the value in this values vector. The declaration is the same as 2D, but again, here dim is 3 instead of 2. So that automatically updates for the new dimension. We'll scroll down to generate mesh. Again, very similar as before to what we had before, except now we have Zmin and Zmax that you'll be defining, the top and bottom boundaries of your domain. Defined boundary conditions will be essentially the same as the 2D problem. Note that node locations in this case is still a vector. Where the row index corresponds to the global node number, and the second index corresponds to the component of the vector. So is it your X, Y, or Z? So in this case, there are three columns in this table, and 0, 1, and 2 correspond to the X, Y, and Z components of the location of each node. All right. So setup system is exactly the same. Any changes that would need to be made in setup system are taken care of by the fact that it's a template class, and so we use dim a lot. For example, in this for loop we use dim, and so now we're looping up to 3 instead of 2. Assemble system is again very similar. The main difference here is that since it's 3D, we have 3 loops over the quadrature rule. All right. So again, this is that sort of tensor product idea with the quadrature points. Each quadrature point technically now becomes a 3D object, but by looping over the 1D rule 3 times, we find all those combinations of quadrature points. Now remember, since we are dealing with, in the 2D problem, 2 quadrature points, in the 3D problem, 3 quadrature points, we also need to multiply by their respectively 2 quadrature weights or 3 quadrature weights, depending on the dimension, when you're doing your numerical integration. Kappa I've also updated to be a 3D or a 3x3 tensor, which we'll use in creating K-local. However, other than that, everything else is the same. Okay, so that it should be very straightforward to go from the 2D problem to the 3D problem. The main challenge will be creating your 3D basis functions and basis function gradients. Going to the 3D means you have twice as many options there, twice as many nodes, so twice as many if statements if you're doing it that method. All right, so that should cover it for the homework 3, coding templates, both 2D and 3D.